You're tuned to FilmNet. Now, it's time for the Hollywood Insider, the latest lowdown on what's up in Hollywood. On this week's Hollywood Insider, comedian Tim Allen's journey from ex-convict to TV star, Harrison Ford on the behind-the-scenes crises of Patriot Games, Mel Gibson was never driven to become a superstar, plus the Judds and country music legends. From Universal Studios Hollywood, Hollywood Insider. Now the host of Hollywood Insider, Shawn Southwick.
Image is everything here in Hollywood, and the stars of one of TV's biggest sitcoms are working hard to improve theirs. Roseanne Arnold has made no secret of the fact that she's dieting and working out, but we've learned that TV husband John Goodman is ready to make even bigger changes in his life. In several interviews, Goodman has confessed he has trouble with alcohol abuse. Now he says he's determined to do something about it before he winds up in a rehabilitation center. Besides his alcohol problem, John is also fighting a battle of the bulge, tipping the scales at around 300 pounds. He lost close to 50 pounds to play Babe Ruth, but then gained much of it back during filming. Like Roseanne, John has started an exercise regime to help his diet plan. Other problems Goodman feels hurt his image are his smoking and his personal appearance. He says he'll give up cigarettes not only for his image, but also for his one-year-old daughter's sake. And he vows to dress well for interviews instead of looking, as he says, like a slob. So the big news from the set of Roseanne is that the stars of this hot domestic comedy are tackling some major personal house cleaning. With his first TV show, Home Improvement, comedian Tim Allen has become a hot comedy star in prime time. But ironically, Tim never set out to become either a comedian or a TV star. In fact, there was a time when his life was headed downhill fast. In a recent interview, Tim revealed his intriguing story. Home Improvement was the only new hit in this last TV season. The sitcom stars comedian Tim Allen as a handyman who's obsessed with power tools.
Tim, you still here?
Oh, yeah. How long has the oil light been on, Jill?
Home Improvement is Tim Allen's big break after 12 years of struggle as a stand-up comic. With all the work that he's put into making it as a performer, you'd assume that Tim's been pursuing some childhood dream. But the fact is, he never set out to be a performer.
I took philosophy and took that as a major. That was my major in college. I loved that. Then I realized every philosopher was ugly and had a horrible life. And you should never pattern yourself after somebody that you wouldn't want to live like. And these guys just weren't bright, cheery guys.
After he graduated from college, Tim's life had no direction. At age 24, he was arrested for selling cocaine to an undercover policeman. He pled guilty to the charge. While waiting to be sentenced, Allen began his stand-up comedy career on a dare from a friend.
He said, you should go to the comedy club, you're so funny, and do this. And for weeks, I kept going, yeah, right. And one day, it just bugged me so much that I was chickening out. I'd go there and just watch, I'm funnier than these guys. It's very difficult to do that. That you can say you're funny, but stand on stage and try to be funny, it's not quite the same thing.
Allen eventually found the courage to go on stage, where he was a success. But no sooner had his promising career began when he was sent to prison for his crime. During his 2-year sentence, he got his priorities straight. After his release, he resumed stand-up comedy and began producing and writing commercials. On the suggestion of someone else, he moved from behind the camera to in front of it.
One time I was in an audition, and I was telling the talent, just say it like this. I'm doing it, and pretty soon one of the guys said, why don't you just do it? And I said, thinking it was no money, I said, come on. It's about $7,000. It went, perfect.
Alan found success performing in commercials while he continued plugging away at his comedy career. After years of one-night stands, his work caught the attention of Disney executives who have given Alan his first TV series. Like stand-up comedy and acting in commercials, a sitcom is something that Alan had never considered before.
When the car didn't get the oil that it needs, it tends to seize up into a rock.
The sudden fame Alan has been given by Home Improvement has overwhelmed him. He says he's much more comfortable with failure than success.
Cars, cash, women, things happening so fast, you can't stop it. That's what I'm frightened of. Believe me, if I failed, there's a million people in this town that would go, all right, now I get a shot at it.
While he's still learning how to cope with instant fame, no one can deny that Tim Allen has come a long way.
Next on Hollywood Insider, Harrison Ford on the off-camera emergencies during the filming of Patriot Games. Plus, how Mel Gibson stumbled onto an amazing career.
With Johnny Carson gone from late-night TV, the battles are heating up among the rest of the late-night talk shows. The latest news is that Arsenio Hall's syndicated show may eventually be dumped from many Fox-affiliated stations. That's because the Fox network plans to premiere a talk show with Chevy Chase in 1993, and they expect their Fox stations to make room for it. All this means Arsenio could be moved to less popular stations or time slots. Paramount Studios, which owns the Arsenio Hall show, claims they're not worried. They say a number of Fox stations have renewed the show through the 1993 season, and they expect them to honor their contracts. Fox, on the other hand, feels Paramount does have something to worry about. They argue it would be hard to imagine any Fox affiliate in September 1993 not giving Chevy priority over Arsenio. Stay tuned. We'll let you know how the chase goes as Chevy joins the late night race. Superstar Harrison Ford stars in the new movie Patriot Games. He plays a CIA operative up against political terrorists bent on personal revenge. To get the movie finished in time for summer, the filmmakers had to overcome some major obstacles. First, they lost their star. Then they had to reshoot part of the movie. When we caught up with Harrison Ford, he gave us the inside story.
Listen, who are we looking for here, huh? IRA terrorists? Or some ultra-violent faction of the IRA.
Harrison Ford stars as former CIA analyst Jack Ryan in Patriot Games, the sequel to the blockbuster The Hunt for Red October. In the film, Ryan has left the CIA seeking a better quality of life with his family. But when he stumbles into a terrorist attack, his family becomes a target. Ryan is drawn back into the dangerous world of secret intelligence.
You'll never get that close to us again, honey. This boy's making calls in the middle of the night. That's all we can do.
Harrison's role was originally intended for Alec Baldwin, who played Jack Ryan in The Hunt for Red October. But Baldwin reportedly backed out at the last minute when scheduling conflicts couldn't be resolved. The Ryan part was offered to Harrison, and he jumped at the opportunity. He was itching to do another action-adventure film.
I'd done 3 or 4 films, which were basically suit and tie jobs, and I thought it would be fun for myself as well as interesting for the audience if I were able to find something in that genre to do. Mm-hmm.
The 50-year-old Ford wanted to get physical again because he felt that if he didn't do an action film soon, he might never again get the opportunity.
You once said when you were talking about action films that you didn't want to be 45 and bouncing off of walls still.
I lied. I'm glad I still have the opportunity to do that kind of film, and I want to preserve that as an option as long as I can.
It was rage. Pure rage.
Bringing a new star onto Patriot Games, particularly a star with lots of clout, meant that the script had to be rewritten. Director Philip Noyce.
And Harrison had his own ideas about the character of Jack Ryan, and he contributed a lot. So yeah, it changed.
And that wasn't the last of the rewriting. After the film was shot and edited, test audiences responded negatively to the film's big climax scene.
We realized at a certain point that part of our ending scene, and only a small part of it, which included a fight underwater, was not as satisfying as we wanted it to be, because anything that you do underwater is rendered into slow motion. It becomes too balletic. It doesn't have the force and energy necessary for the moment that we were dealing with.
The film's climax was hurriedly rewritten, and luckily Harrison was available for the additional shooting. Frenzied editors have worked around the clock to finish the movie on time. So for Harrison Ford and the others who made Patriot Games, the ordeal behind the scenes was every bit as tense as what's on the screen.
Where do stars go when they want to get away from Hollywood for some fresh mountain air? Well, it used to be the upscale ski resort of Aspen, Colorado. But sources say the new in-place for celebrities is Telluride. This tiny Colorado village of just 1,300 people is nestled high in the Rocky Mountains, hundreds of miles from any interstate highway. Some of Hollywood's biggest stars have already made it their home away from home. Sylvester Stallone bought a giant spread. He's said to be subdividing it so he can sell lots to some of his Hollywood friends. Director Oliver Stone owns a 1,000-acre parcel of land, and talk show queen Oprah Winfrey spent $3 million for an 83-acre ranch. The sudden buying frenzy in Telluride has sent land prices rising as high as the ski slopes, and this is making many local residents nervous. So they've enacted strict zoning laws to control growth. Residents hope to prevent Telluride from becoming another overcrowded retreat like Aspen. This former sleepy mining town is determined not to be buried by an avalanche of Hollywood glitter. Mel Gibson is back with a vengeance in the eagerly awaited sequel, Lethal Weapon 3. Most actors labor long and hard to make it as a superstar, but not Mel. In a candid interview, he revealed how success just came his way.
Well, I can't shoot a dog. People are okay, but not dogs. I think I should try and make friends with him. Yeah.
After Mel Gibson finished high school, one of his sisters enrolled him in a prestigious Australian drama school. Mel was more interested in becoming a journalist, but then he decided that might be too much work. So he auditioned at the drama school and was accepted. He went on to perform in a number of stage productions. Then, at the age of 23, he got his first big movie break as Mad Max. This was the start of a superstar career that was far from planned.
You say that you've never really planned out your life.
Yeah, 6 months down the track is as far as I can see. And that's a problem. It used to only be 2 or 3 months. But now it's turned into 6 months.
And what do you attribute that
to? Pretty soon
it'll
be years. I don't know. I think it's consideration of other people. You have to kind of plan for them because they're kind of connected in some way, so you have to be considerate.
There is no bomb in that building. I will bet vital parts of my anatomy to the fact. Now look, just look.
Today, Mel is a bona fide superstar with an impressive list of movie credits, including the Lethal Weapon series. Though Lethal Weapon 3 is shaping up to be one of this year's monster hits, Mel had some reservations about doing another Lethal Weapon sequel.
A lot of actors are reluctant to do sequels.
Well, I am too, but you because they're dangerous, you know, you can't easily kind of drop the ball if you're not grounded. But if you're with the same mob like Donner and Joel and Danny and so forth, everybody knows where you left off, so it's easy to build on.
What was the biggest challenge for you in making this film?
Challenge? To make it better than the other two, I think. To sort of go one better. Because that's the problem with sequels, is rehashing the same old stuff or going backwards, you know, or getting lackluster with it. So the biggest challenge was to get there and mm-hmm. keep it alive, and if anything, go a step further with it.
But look, watch, a whole family of 44s on the back. Yeah, there they are.
That's impressive.
One coming through, got one got stuck in my lung. I was breathing blood bubbles. It was disgusting.
The same kind of ease that made Mel a superstar is also reflected in the way he deals with being a celebrity. For him, it's something you just don't take seriously.
If you take this stuff seriously, there's something wrong. I've known myself ever since I was a kid, and it's, I mean, if you start believing this stuff you read and that's said, perhaps you can get carried away, but I feel kind of uncomfortable with that. You know, that's the Twilight Zone, isn't it?
You have the right to remain unconscious. Anything you say ain't gonna be much. Mm-hmm. Act a bit.
Next on Hollywood Insider, country music legends and the Judds.
Many people dream of becoming a star. They imagine celebrity parties, exotic travel, adoring fans, and a lavish lifestyle. But one man has discovered that with the dream, there's a sad reality. In his book, Starstruck, Celebrity Performers and the American Public, Dr. Jib Foles reveals a shocking fact. He claims that stars die on average 13 years younger than the typical American. So why do stars die younger? Well, according to Dr. Foles, one reason is that celebrities travel all the time. This increases their risk of being killed in travel-related accidents. For example, music stars Buddy Holly, Otis Redding, and Patsy Cline all died in airplane crashes. But a more significant reason for shorter lifespans is substance abuse. Elvis Presley, Marilyn Monroe, John Belushi, Dennis Wilson, Judy Garland, and Jimi Hendrix all died this way. Foles says it's the pressures of fame that ultimately turn a star to alcohol or drugs. So celebrities may indeed live an enviable life, but they also face the unenviable reality that it may be cut short. Two new home videos give country music fans the opportunity to see the Judds say farewell and relive the magic of some of their favorite artists. Here's a preview of the Judds, their final concert, and Country Gold Volume 1, so you can decide whether to add them to your video collection. During the 8 years they were together, the Judds became the most successful female team in the history of country music. They created 6 gold records and 14 number one country hits. And the duo won 4 Grammys, as well as almost every other major country music award.
Well, I think Winona and I love country music more right this minute than we did the day we discovered it.
But all of that came to an end on December 4th, 1991, when Naomi and Winona Judd performed together in concert for the very last time. The home video, The Judds, Their Final Concert, puts viewers front and center as Naomi and Winona give an emotional but upbeat farewell performance.
Silence so deep only my soul can hear, says now the past is what I feel.
While Winona has continued her career, her mother Naomi was forced to retire. Suffering from chronic active hepatitis, Naomi had to give up the demanding lifestyle required of a touring musician.
I love you, and you will always be my favorite partner.
The concert was filmed in Murfreesboro, Tennessee, country music's heartland. Surrounded by family and their most devoted fans, the Judds perform one hit after another.
Mama, he's crazy, crazy of me.
This intimate concert tape spotlights a contemporary country music act. Another home video, called Country Gold Volume 1, features some of Nashville's most legendary performers.
Yeah, I'm proud.
This home video includes performances by classic country artists such as Loretta Lynn, Waylon Jennings, the Carter Family, Merle Haggard, and Ernest Tubb. Altogether, they belt out 17 of country music's biggest selling hits.
I'm walking the floor over you. I can't sleep a wink, that is true.
These two home videos present country's finest. Country Gold Volume 1 pays tribute to the Nashville heavyweights who laid a musical foundation for today's hot country stars. The Judds, their final concert, bids farewell to one of this era's most successful country duos.
Goodbye, America. It's been one heck of a ride.
Next on Hollywood Insider, some obscure names for rock music's biggest bands.
Transportation for some Hollywood Insider guests is provided by Dayvale Chauffeured Ground Transportation Network.
One of the more challenging aspects of being a successful rock and roll band is coming up with a unique name for the group. So, not surprisingly, most rock supergroups have tried out other names before they came up with their winning handles. We've done a little investigating to dig up some of those earlier attempts at band names that didn't quite work. This Irish rock group started out with two not-so-catchy names, The Hype, then The Virgin Prunes. They finally settled on U2. And today, they're one of the hottest bands on the music scene. Johnny and the Moondogs is the obscure former name of one of the most popular groups in music history. Johnny and the Moondogs was the name used by the Beatles for a couple of years.
Love, love me do.
Another original name of a rock supergroup that didn't quite catch on was Little Boy Blue and the Blue Boys. They later became the Rolling Stones, led by the Peter Pan of rock, Mick Jagger.
You're not the only one. When you see motion.
Here are some other intriguing original names of well-known bands. Def Leppard was formerly Atomic Mass, and Carl and the Passions became the Beach Boys. Apparently, music talent alone is not enough to make a band a super band. The group must also have a name that sings. And that's a wrap for today. I'm Shawn Southwick. Thanks for joining us on Hollywood Insider, the show with the inside line on what's happening in Hollywood.
Town. I invited her over for dinner. But Angela says they're busy.
Angela!
Everybody loves Angela the